Ain't nothing but against the party. Hello everybody, welcome back to another Penny Dreadful video on my channel. I'm back after quite a long break. Honestly, I was just kind of got caught up in election coverage, and then the NBA season started, and I don't know. Just one thing led to another, and I haven't really been doing a lot of magic stuff, which is, honestly, if you're going to follow my channel, likely to happen from time to time. We'll just go through phases, especially, you know, playing Penny Dreadful. After a while, the format gets a little stale, and I actually recorded some videos that I never got around to posting. The other thing is my computer's kind of slow. But appreciate everybody who kept following along. You know, I got all of your emails and your tweets and the petitions and all that stuff begging me to come back and record more videos. So here I am. So thank you to all my devoted fans. So today what we have is a deck actually that I built for the last season, but then got some really good upgrades for this season. And I'm excited to try it out. I have not played any games with this. I've done some practice, just like solitaire things to make sure the engine works right, but I haven't played against actual competition yet. So, what is this deck? It is a mono-red aggro deck with a few different twists that make it pretty spicy. So, first of all, very excited about... you know what? Hold that thought. I should give a really quick intro for those who haven't watched Penny Dreadful before. This format... is a Magic Online only format. Every card in the format costs 2 cents or less on MTGO traders. After every set, they basically check the prices for 2 weeks, and then whatever cards are 2 cents or less for at least, I think, half of their checks become legal. So the format rotates basically in the same way that Standard rotates. Anyways, we have a new format now. So two cards that rotated in are Goblin Bushwhacker and Reckless Bushwhacker. I think... Goblin maybe has been before, but I think Reckless, this is the first time ever being legal in Penny Dreadful. But I'm very excited to be able to play 8 whack decks, and there will be more of them, I'm sure. And so I kind of added them into this mono-red party shell. So the party mechanic, which was from the last set, Zendikar Rising, and... the idea is your party consists of one each of a cleric, rogue, warrior, and wizard. So you just want to build a deck that has a nice distribution of those card types. And as it happens, both bushwhackers are warriors, so that adds one to that. The other card that really makes the deck work is Goblin Electromancer, which is a wizard, and it's a 3-2 for 3, and you add red for each creature in your party when it comes into play. So you can do some really cool things, especially... you know, playing Electromancer into one of the Bushwhacker effects. And the other card that works really great with it is Priest of Urabrask, which is a 3-mana 2-1 that adds 3 red when it comes to play. And really importantly, it's actually one of the only red clerics. So if you play a warrior on turn 2, and then a priest on turn 3, and then an Electromancer, the Electromancer automatically adds 3 because you have warrior, cleric, and wizard, and then you can kind of go off from there. So the other card, two cards that work with party... our Grotag Bug Catcher, which it is a 1-2 for 2 with trample, and it gets +1/+0 when it attacks for each creature in your party. So at the very least, it's a 2-2 for 2 with trample, which is not the end of the world. And almost always, it's at least a 3-2 or a 4-2. And then we also have Shatterskull Minotaur, which is a 5-4 haste for 6 mana, but it costs 1 less for each creature in your party. So this is often a 3 or 2 mana 5-4 haste, or even a 4 mana 5-4 haste is fine. I only have 3. I had 4... The only problem is they get a little awkward in multiples because this is such a really fast aggro deck. And especially with the Bushwhackers, you have other things that you want to play off of, like Electromancer. So, what else do we have? So, let me pause real quick. I'm going to show you the distribution of the creature types. Okay, so this is how the creature types break down. All of these are warriors. We have a lot of warriors, especially the fact that you have, you know, these are all warriors... and the bug catcher is a warrior. It means you do have a lot of warriors in this deck, but that's kind of fine. The way that it curves out works reasonably well, and you don't really need always to have 4 party cards. Like, you're not so all in on the party mechanic. Like, you really only need 3, and oftentimes, like, even if you have, you play an Ardent Electromancer with just 2 mana, you can still play a Bushwhacker effect off of it. So it's really not hard to make this deck run well. So you have 6 wizards. Grim Lavamancer, an excellent wizard. It's not amazing in this deck because you are mostly creature-based, so you don't get a ton of cards in your graveyard. You also don't have fetch lands, but it's really good against creature decks, and there are plenty of ways. You know, you're playing a lot of creatures, they're going to die, and then you can Lavamancer. We have four Foundry Street Denizens, which are warriors. This is a really great card in a deck like this. It would be even better if it was a different creature type, like, you know, wizard, rogue, or cleric. But even as a warrior, you know, being able to chain together multiple of these, like, Electromancer effects makes this just often a 3/4 or 5/1 for 1, which is really, really powerful. And then in terms of the rogues, we have three Goblin Instigators, which is a 2-mana 1/1 that makes another 1/1. So it's basically a dragon fodder, but it's a rogue. Also works really nicely with Foundry Street Denizen and with the Bushwhacker effects, having two creatures. Tin Street Dodger, it's not a great card. It's just a 1-1 haste for 1 that can poke in for some damage if you can kind of be unblockable for 1 mana each turn, oftentimes. So, you know, it's fine. It's mostly a 1-mana 1-1 rogue. And then we have one Reckless Waif, which is also a rogue, human rogue werewolf. It flips if your opponent doesn't play a creature card. So we have a good distribution of creatures, and you know, most of the creatures are just fine cards on their own. The other really nice thing is we get to play three Goblin Grenades, which is also a new card in the format. This might honestly be better as a four of, because you just happen to have a bunch of goblins. Tin Street Dodger, Goblin Instigator, Grotek Bugcatcher, Foundry Street Denizen, both of the Bushwhackers. Like, there's just a lot of goblins by accident in this deck. So being able to play a 1-mana 5-damage spell is really awesome to just finish things off. 20 Mountains, nothing complicated there. Sideboard, we have, this is a, I have honestly no idea how to build a sideboard. I haven't really been checking the metagame. I looked a little bit at what decks are being played so far, and it's not really clear to me. But, you know, I have four Smash the Smithereens. I think probably some sort of artifact deck will be a thing. It's just like an easy inclusion, a lazy inclusion, honestly. Two Reckless Waifs. These seem good against, like, Drago control decks. Just, it's a better one drop that can just be a 3-2. Against other creature decks, two more Lavamancers, an Arc Trail, and a Chain Lightning. Maybe this should be just like one more. Actually, you know what? I know I already have submitted my deck list. Yeah, so something like this. And then three Price of Progress against decks where Price of Progress is good, because this is a good card. And two Harsh Mentors. Not exactly sure where these are good, but it's a cleric, and there's, again, almost no clerics in red. So it's nice to be able to sideboard in something that could potentially be really powerful that's also a cleric. So that is the deck, and I will be back for round one with some game action. All right, here we go. Round one against Neji Bambeji. Not sure if that's how you pronounce it. And unfortunately, we do have a mulligan. Oof. Is it better than a random five? No, I think we have to go to five, which is probably not good for this deck, but let's keep this. This is actually a really good hand. I think we're bottoming Lavamancer. Ooh. And what else? This is really close. Maybe we don't need the priest. Man, that would have been still a really good even six, but at five, definitely gets hurt. All right, so they play an Ancient Stirrings. Let's see what spice they've got going. I forget if, all right, I assume this is Tron or Cloudpost. I don't know if all the Tron pieces rotate in. Cloudpost is still legal, so I guess probably more likely that. Oh, that's a nice draw. So we can curve a warrior, rogue, wizard into Minotaur. So next turn we attack for three, and then we can attack for a lot of damage on turn two. I mean, on turn three. All right, so they get a Sylvan Scry. They have a really slow draw, so hopefully we can punish that even on a multi five. All right, they get their Cloudpost, but they don't even have one in play. Ooh, interesting. we don't want to play that, because if we play that, then the Electromancer only will create two mana on turn three. Although we don't actually have a third land, but I think we're going to play hoping that we draw one. Yeah, if we don't draw a third land, things could get awkward. All right, attack for three. They're going to play a Cloudpost tapped, I think. We're going to explore, sure. If they have a Glimmer Post? No, they don't. Ooh, they don't even have another post. All right. Ooh, that's not what we wanted. All right, well, let's play it. Attack for four. Let's close this. They haven't said anything. Hmm. If we draw a land next turn, we're doing okay. All right, so they're scrying. Get another cloud post. They'll only have access to 3 mana this turn. They get a glimmer post. That makes sense. They gain 2. We don't care as much about glimmer post as some decks might. Just because this deck kind of goes over the top of small amounts of life gain with like big turns like this. But we will see. You got a cloud post. Ooh. All right. Well, I'll take that draw. That is, I'd say, just as good as a land here. I don't know how much damage this is, but it's a lot. Ooh, put them to 2. Nice. Okay, so they can only gain 3 this turn anyways, but I'm not quite sure. Well, I don't know if there's some card they can play to get them out of this. Not sure. I don't know if there's a Wrath. Like, I don't think all this dust is in this format. They go up to 5 off the Glimmer Post, but we still have more than lethal on board. They can make 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 mana. Not sure what's in the format for 7 right now. And they scooped. Sweet. All right. Well, that was a really slow draw by them. This is like a generally a pretty good matchup, but their fast draws can go over the top sometimes. All right. What I want. Reckless Waif seems pretty good. Well, it seems okay. They do have like maps and stuff, so maybe it's not that good, especially on the draw, but it might be better than Lavamancer. There's Smash the Smithereens. There's Price of Progress. These are okay. They kind of only hit maps, and they're not even that good at maps. I'm not quite sure what their threats are. They probably play Steel Hellkite, though, which is something to look out for. All right, I'm going to cut the Lavamancers and, like, a grenade. I think I just want to play Price of Progress. Maybe I just want to play Price of Progress over all these grenades. And put another Reckless Waif and 1 Smash. And let's see what Smash is like against them. I want to make sure, you know, we still have... This deck needs a lot of creatures. Harsh Mentor punishes map. They do have other lands that do stuff, but not a lot. Do I want that instead of like a Goblin Instigator? Sure. Why not? Let's try that. I don't know. It's kind of sloppy sideboarding, but let's see how it goes. I assume Steel Hellkite is a hard we have to worry about. Man, we've had some awkward opening hands. Going to 6. All right, we'll keep this. We put back the Tin Street Dodger, right? Means we only have rogues. I mean, only have warriors. Could put back the Foundry Street Denizen. So what's our curve? Turn 1... I think we want to do this. Hopefully we'll just draw something else. And even if this is only a 2-2, this just does more damage. All right, what do they have? Ooh, our Boreal Grazer is a good one. This card's really good against us. I mean, we go pretty wide, so it's not the end of the world, but it's still pretty decent. All right, that's pretty good. So next turn we go Bugcatcher, and then we go Priest into Bushwhacker. Hopefully we can draw another 1-drop or an Electromancer. Yep, someone's crying. Ghost Quarter does nothing. They get their Cloud Post. They play their Cloud Post. Pass the turn. Okay. Interesting. No. I was thinking I could just kick a Bushwhacker this turn. They kind of would be forced to take 5 or lose their Grazer, but I'm just going to pass. I mean, I could insult them by attacking, but whatever. All right, next turn, we could play a Bushwhacker for one and then kick a Bushwhacker, but I think probably we just want to priest into kicked Bushwhacker. Yep, map. Yep, map. You're going to get Glimmer Post? You're going to get Cloud Post? They're going to get Cloud Post. Yeah, all right. So probably next turn they can do a lot. They'll have 7 mana at least. Next turn if they play a Glimmer Post or a Cloud Post, they'll have 3, 6, 7, 8 mana. Ooh, okay. What does that do? Nothing, because we only have 2 creature types. Warrior, Cleric. Yeah, all right. Okay, well, we're definitely playing the Priest. Now I'm trying to think, do we want to play a Bushwhacker? So next turn, now we still only have 2 creature types. So next turn we might not be able to play Shadow Skull Minotaur. So this Bushwhacker represents 2-3 damage this turn, because it attacks for 2, plus it pumps this one. It does so much more next turn. All right, we're just going to cast this a kicker. All right, so this is a lot of damage coming at them. 13 damage. All right, they're going to keep their Grazer around, take 11. Ooh. What do they have here? Glimmer Post up to 12. They need something that stabilizes the board. It can't just be like one big creature. Prophetic Prism, that's not going to do it. All right, Harsh Mentors are good against Prophetic Prisms. Oh, no. These are mana abilities. Never mind. Explore. All right, that's not really going to do it either. Another Glimmer Post would be good, obviously. Looks like they're digging for something. Another Prism. Yeah, like the look of this. Stirrings. There's really not much they can do off of a Stirrings. You can get another Glimmer Post. Yeah, they still have a land drop to play this turn because they explored. One Explorer. Mindslaver. Cool. I mean, Mindslaver doesn't do that much against us. Like, they can only just attack. Oh, that's a nice draw. Nice draw. Yeah, I'm really glad we did not play Bushwhacker last turn. This is representing so much fucking damage now. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Like, I don't know. It's like 13 damage that the Bushwhacker added. This is gotta be lethal. Ooh, interesting. Oh, do they have like a fog, like a moment's piece? Tangle. Fuck. Fuck. Yikes, that was good. 2, 4, 5, 6, 7. Alright, they can play Mindslaver. They can't use Mindslaver. We also awkwardly just have all warriors. This is the problem with Foundry Street Denizen as your one drop. This deck does have too many warriors to work exactly as we would like it to work. But I assume they're going to go get a Glimmer Post now. I mean, again, Mindslaver just doesn't do anything against us, right? They can't even kill. Okay, they can Buried Ruin, so they can Mindslaver twice. Still doesn't do anything. But they, I mean, if they get a creature, they can start suiciding them at least. Oh, Platinum Angel. Well, that's a problem. I mean, do we want to play this out, hoping to find the one of, what's it called? One Smash? I'm just going to scoop this. Platinum Angel. Did not realize this was in the format. I think it was last format too. I totally forgot about the card. Okay. I don't know. I guess I could have played it out, but if you've watched my videos, I don't really have a lot of
patience for games where I'm like 2% to win. We just were gonna have to sit there draw go with our smash while they multiple times mindslaver us. I don't know. All right. What do we think about Harsh Mentor again? So stuff like Buried Ruin, sure. We need more smashes if they're gonna mindslaver and Platinum Angel us. We might even want four. It's close. I'm gonna cut the Harsh Mentor, I think. Could probably cut one of these. I don't want to cut too many of our other creature types. Cut a bug catcher. Maybe I only want three smashes. Maybe I only want two prices. I don't know. Reckless Waif. I guess I'll only play three smashes. I don't know. Maybe that's crazy. It's only like okay against most of their deck. I mean, it's pretty good against Platinum Angel. Yeah, I'm gonna keep this. This hand doesn't have a one drop, which is never ideal, but it has the lands. It needs turn two Instigator. On the play, this is a lot better than on the draw. So we have to go Mountain Pass. But next turn, we play Instigator, and then we play Electromancer into Bushwhacker, which is pretty good. That's a lot of damage. Stirrings or map, sure. So here, I guess we have the option. Of smashing that. After that, we could play like Electromancer into Tin Street Dodger, or we could like. Nah. I think we want to do our thing. I think we care less about disrupting their thing. And hopefully, the smash can just kill their big threat. Yeah, this is the other thing that we might have ended up having another chance to kill this. Something's growing. Alright, Cloudpost it is. That's interesting. So we can play Electromancer, make two mana, and Bushwhacker. That's 2, 4, 6. 10 damage. And then next turn, we just like play Tin Street Dodger and Foundry Street Denizen. Alternatively, we play Denizen, smash their expedition map, and then attack for 2. And then next turn, we go Electromancer, make 3 mana, Dodger, Bushwhacker, and attack for a lot. This is plus 3, so 4, 5. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 17. So that's actually lethal next turn. All right, I think I like that. They can't really disrupt that plan, and there's not like that much they can do like to not die next turn besides play like a Glimmer Post, which means they're not really developing their board or their mana. Like, the one thing it would punish us is Explore into Glimmer Post plus Cloud Post. Prophetic Prism. Sure. And they play the Cloud Post. I think we just have lethal here. I'm pretty sure. Oh, now we definitely have lethal. All right. Oh, yes. Always yield. Sure, always yield. In Street Dodger. Cast with Surge.
make this unable to block just for good luck instead of wasting the mana. And that's definitely lethal.
Woo! Nice. Negative six. Sweet. That was a really nice showing, especially considering the deck did not draw very well. Although, to be fair, our opponent didn't really either. I think those were not great draws by our opponent. But still, you know, we lost the Platinum Angel, but this last game was really nice, being able to disrupt them and then just do a shit ton of damage on the last turn. So I will be back for the next round.
All right, round two. Won the die roll. Definitely play first.
Yeah, this is definitely a keep.
Keepsies. Turn one, Tin Street Dodger. Turn two, Bug Catcher or Instigator. We could kick a Bushwhacker.
We'll see.
If they play just like Land Go, well, I guess it depends which land they play. I'm leaning towards just playing a Bug Catcher. They play Mountain. Interesting. Goblin Cohort. Okay. Yeah, let's play the Bug Catcher. Can't attack into that. It's actually kind of annoying. So this is the Mono Red Mirror. Ooh, and they have nothing. Well, that's good. We'll have to figure out a way to surge this. Hopefully we draw an Electromancer. That would be the ideal draw here. Otherwise, next turn... Ooh, they may have just fucked up. That may be the pause that they accidentally clicked through their turn and didn't play something so they couldn't attack. They may have just like blindly gone to attacks, forgetting that they have to play the creature pre-combat. Yeah, it looks like that. Oh, and a haster. I mean, they wouldn't have been able to attack with it, but oh, that's fine. But I guess they realize they're taking a creature type off the board, so fair enough. What am I doing here? Land. I'm just going to play an Instigator and attack. Get in a point of damage, trade off, and then next turn I can, you know, maybe potentially kick a Goblin Bushwhacker. I can play another Bug Catcher. If I draw a land, then I'll probably play Bug Catcher into Reckless Bushwhacker, or I'll definitely do that. So yeah, we definitely right now are either looking for either a one drop or a land so that we can surge out Reckless Bushwhacker. Yep. And they're trading very slowly. Oh, they have a burn spell. Sure. They decided not to use it. Okay. I guess they realized that using a burn spell on a Goblin Instigator probably isn't the best tactic. Signal Pest. Yep, that's a nice one. I'm building a lot of red decks with Signal Pests in them. They're not snow-covered mountains, which means they're not playing... what is that? Icehide Golem? Is that the right card? It's a 2-2 for 1 snow mana, but snow-covered mountains are legal now, so you can just play a 2-2 for 1 in red. Okay. Oh. Shit. Okay. This is awkward because they have the Fanatical Firebrand out. So Electromancer seems like a nut draw, but if I play Electromancer, they Firebrand the Instigator in response, then I only have one party creature type and I can't do anything off of it. So the plan is instead to either Bushwhacker or Grotag Bug Catcher. I'm going to Bushwhacker, I think. Yeah.
I'm going to Bushwhacker. And attack with everything. So I'm guessing they like block and sack, take two. Oh, they just took it all. Well, that's good. Because next turn I can Electromancer. I mean, unless they play another Firebrand. Well, we do think that they probably have a removal spell. All right, Rakdos Cackler. It's not great here. Yeah, it can't block. They're not the beatdown currently. And they have their own Bushwhacker. Okay. Makes them a little beater downer. That's a lot of damage. Signal Pest is very powerful. I really wish this was had a party creature type. It's honestly almost maybe playable anyways, but. Okay. So right now we do have three. So we're going to go for it. I think this is lethal. They probably burn something in response. No, they don't. Or maybe now they do it. No, they still don't. I assumed that the last card in their hand was a burn spell, but I guess it isn't. Obviously, we want to play the Foundry Street first so we can get the trigger off of the Reckless Bushwalker, or both triggers off the Reckless Bushwalker. They kill this 3, 5, 7, 9, 11. All right, so it's not lethal if they killed the Ardent Electromancer. 2, 3, 5, 7. They don't have lethal either, so I'm swinging. They can't both have a burn spell and a Bushwhacker. I mean, I'm basically trying to figure out what my outs are. Sweet. All right, we won. I was trying to figure out whether I should keep something back to block, but they didn't have lethal unless, like, they had to kill something to not die. So if they have a burn spell, they could not die this turn, but then they can't kill us next turn unless they have a burn spell and then, like, drew a Bushwhacker. That would be their out, or potentially a Haster. So they could definitely have won that, but they did not have it. So, hooray. Okay, so. Yeah, I mean, I think our little Lavamancer sideboard plan seems fine. Again, Lavamancer's not amazing here, but it's fine. Smash the Smithereen seems probably not good enough. Harsh Mentor? It's really just good against Fanatical Firebrand. I don't think that's enough. It is a 2-2. Well, what am I taking out? I'm definitely taking out the Reckless Wave for a Grim Lavamancer. Can probably cut like a Tin Street Dodger as well. What else do I want to cut? Maybe I don't want two Grim Lavamancers. One is fine. I should probably not be playing two. Could cut a Grenade. Yeah. Try to control the board a little bit more. Although Grenade, if you control the board, then Grenade goes over the top. But I think our deck goes over the top anyways, so. This seems fine. Interesting. What do we think about this hand? It's really powerful, but it only has one land. It's not that good either. I'm going to go to 6. Ugh. Yeah. Do I keep this? At least this hand has the outs to just, like, draw, like, a 1 and a 2 drop. And it's, like, pretty decent. I don't know. Maybe this is just a mulligan. Maybe this was stupid. Feels like it's probably better than going to 5, but going to 5 on the draw is not quite as bad. I don't know. All right, they have their own Foundry Street. Huh. Goblin Bushwhacker.
Okay. Might end up kicking that on turn two. They don't have a creature. Okay. Do they have nothing? They have a signal pest? What is this? Wow, they are really bad at playing their creatures pre-combat. My goodness. All right. Play a Foundry Street Denizen. Man, Ash Cell. This should probably be in my sideboard. Yeah, this was in the last season's version of the deck because it's a warrior. I already have so many warriors, though. But this is, like, a first striker is really good in the mirror. Really good. Maybe I should have just Goblin Grenaded the Ash Zealot. Hopefully they attack here. Ooh, Fanatical Firebrand. Okay. Wow. That's really good.
Yeah, they pick that off. I'm pretty fucked here. What do I got? Land. I can go nothing. Yeah, I'm screwed. All right. Go to game three. Yeah, maybe Ash Cell in the sideboard is a nice one for the mirror. It seems like there is a lot of mono red going around with all these Bushwhacker effects. There's a lot of good one drops and stuff that have rotated in. Foundry Street is back. It wasn't legal last time. All right. Fine with this. That was a bad draw. I mean, I drew okay after that initial one, but they had some good answers to what I was doing anyways. Lavamancer just isn't that good against Fanatical Fireburn and stuff, though. That's the other thing. It's good against, like, green decks. Ugh. Man. Ugh. Not been drawing well. All right. Tin Street Dodger kill their first play. Nah. Okay, this is better-ish.
Back up land. I'm just going to play the Dodger first.
Get a bit dodgy. Denizen Arena.
All right, definitely offering the trade here because I have a Lavamancer and this isn't doing shit.
It is providing another creature type for Grotek Butt Bug Butt Catcher. Grotek Butt Catcher. No Ash Zealots, please. Wayward Guy Beast. Man, I really was excited to see this card had rotated in, but it's like kind of bad. I don't know. Just way worse than you want it to be. So many draws are just so awkward because this card is in your hand. It is not the Goblin Guide 2.0 that I think people were hoping. I mean, this is the type of game where it's really shining, though. Damn. Getting punished for putting that land back, huh? All right. I could play a Lavamancer here to... I'm just going to play... Well, I guess let me attack first. Yeah, I definitely wish I had land over Goblin Grenade right now, but... Grenade plus Lavamancer is nice because puts two things in your yard. So I can kind of do seven out of nowhere. Or do five and kill something of theirs. Hopefully they trade. They're not going to. Yeah. Hopefully they don't have a follow-up of a Bushwhacker. Although... Goblin Instigator is pretty nice in the mirror here because it can block two Foundry Streets. Plus, we already have a Rogue in Tin Street Dodger, so this creature type isn't important. So if we, like, block, that's really nice value.
Yeah, they're only going to attack with the Wayward Guy Beast. Nice.
Do we want to double block? It's kind of interesting. There's also a play of single block, take one. They have to bounce a land anyways, and now we have a thing in for Lavamancer. But I think the fact that we still couldn't use Lavamancer next turn, and the fact that sacking something with Goblin Grenade would be useful, like we don't want to sack this, is reason not to do that. They didn't play the lands, man. There's some loose play going on here. Okay. What are we playing here? I guess, because we can't do lethal. Is there anything we can do? Like if we go Electromancer, Lavamancer, Grenade, unblockable, five, we go block, take four or five. That's not lethal. Okay. Play an Electromancer, pumps up our Bug Catcher.
Bug Catcher.
One, two, our part is two. It's about to go to three. And then a Lavamancer, well, that's still three. I have to play it pre-combat, unfortunately. Oh, wait. Oh, fuck. That was stupid. I meant to give this unblockable. I'm fine. Like, if they want to trade here and here so that we'd no longer have a rogue in play for Bugcatcher, it's not the end of the world. Like, then we've killed two Foundry Street Denizens, and we're still left with a much, much, much better board. And a Goblin Grenade in hand and a Grim Lavamancer in play where, like, this puts two creatures into our graveyard. So if they want to get rogues off the board, they lose two Foundry Streets and let our Lavamancer pick off their Wayward Guy Beast or whatever. So we're in a really good spot here. This is seven damage, which means that we have lethal next turn if they just take this with a Goblin Grenade plus a Lavamancer. I'm not quite sure what they can do to get out of this. This not playing a land was really rough for them. I mean, I don't know what's in their hand, but they really needed a second land in play. Like, if they wanted to get out of this, it would involve, like, playing three creatures next turn. So this is where Wayward Guy Beast is pretty awkward. Especially, yeah, if you bounce lands and then don't replay them. Because they didn't play a land last turn. So I'm assuming they only have two. I don't even know what they could have in their hand. Like, they had two lands last turn. They didn't play one, so that would assume that they don't have a land in hand, besides the one that they bounced. So that means they have five spells in hand, and none of them they can cast for two mana. Or, I mean, they seem to be just like, I don't know, they keep misclicking. They click through their attack step a bunch of times. They're playing Hasters post-combat. So I don't know, maybe they're just like misclicking. Okay. This works also very well, especially like it's a trampler, so we still deal a good amount of damage. So now we still have lethal, although it requires us to attack, but we can attack it in for two and then Lavamancer plus grenade. We can even make this unblockable so that we're guaranteed to A, get in 1 point of damage, and B, have a goblin after combat. Priest of Urbrask. I actually don't think we want to play that. So we make this unblockable. Attack with these. They block here. They take three. Then grenade plus Lavamancer. Yeah. So even if they have a removal spell, they, like, let's say they kill this, block there, they take two and they're still dead. So they would need two removal spells here or some sort of... Oops. Not that one. Double removal spell. I'm hoping that our, in general, this deck, because we have the party mechanic in it, it
leads our opponents to aggressively take take creature types off the board, when in fact we don't care all that much about the party mechanic particularly. Like, some games it matters, but a lot of games it's not that important. Anyways, hooray. 2-0. Nice start to the deck. Definitely a little bit of loose play from our opponent, but this deck does sweet things, and especially considering we haven't drawn very well, I've been pretty happy with it. So we will see you all back for round three. Okay, here we are, round three. We're going to keep this hand. This hand's really, really good if we draw a Bushwhacker effect or a Minotaur, and otherwise is a little... if we draw lands... it's a little medium because, you know, we can play the awesome Urbrask into Electromancer combo, but we can't do anything with the mana if we don't have another card to play. All right, Coiling Oracle. Interesting. Maybe this is like a... Ooh, that's... It always feels so busted when they hit a land off of Coiling Oracle. Lavamancer is not an ideal draw there. I'm not going to attack. Just going to play an Instigator. Man, Coiling Oracle's beating here. Yeah, even holds back our 10 Street Dodger. Going Priest into Electromancer into make this unblockable and play a Lavamancer is not an ideal turn. So, okay. So I think they are playing Neoform. That's a really... bad use of Archimedes. Jesus. That's not what we want to draw. I think they're playing a Neoform deck. I actually built and played a Neoform deck for a video, but I don't think I ever posted it. It was pretty sweet. It used like Delve cards and I forget what the other cards, but some cards that you could like cheat things out kind of quickly and then Neoform them into like 8 drops and 9 drops. It was kind of sweet. Well, shit. So we have a few considerations here. One thing is that if we draw a Reckless Bushwhacker, we can't play it if we play all our hand. Like, if we just dump everything in our hand, we can't actually cast a Reckless Bushwhacker. So we could keep Lavamancer back. I don't know. I'm going to keep the Lavamancer in hand. I should just not be playing the Lavamancer. It's just too hard to ever really be able to utilize it. I mean, we're kind of in for almost any one for one that has a party type, but all right, they have traverses as well. Maybe they're just like a blue green value deck also. It's possible. They get an island. So next turn we can still at least attack with like these. Okay. So now do we want to, I think I'm going to attack with this and this. Let me just make sure. Going to give this unblockable-ish. See if they want to trade for both their creatures. They're going to chump. Okay. Are they going to Neoform? Ghostly Flicker. Oof. Jeez. That's a nice one. Yeah, I think this is this Neoform deck that plays Ghostly Flicker. Theirs is a lot more of a value build. I don't know if Wizard of Oz, if they are the person who invented this deck. I saw somebody did well with it, or at least, I don't actually remember if they did well with it, but they at least played it. What did they reveal? Oh, they revealed a Oracle, Coiling Oracle to a Coiling Oracle. But yeah, Ghostly Flicker plus Archaeomancer is so nice. This gets back an instant or sorcery, for those who don't know the card.
We're going to play a bug catcher. And we're still going to keep the Lavamancer back for now.
I think we're not doing great here. I think this is going to be tough to get out of. Their end game is just going to be so much better than ours. But hopefully we can maybe catch them slipping on a turn and try Bushwhacker and kind of lethal them in one turn. Jesus, that's not what we want. But Tramplers are good against the Ghostly Flicker idea. Yeah, I think I like a swing with everything plan now. They might trade for the priest, which does hurt our bug catcher, but I think I'm going to go for it. If they have a Neoform mid-combat here, this could get really ugly, but it is a 5-2. Hopefully this puts some stuff in our graveyard. Play a Lavamancer. I don't know. We'll see. Now we have two things that can peck away. All right. Are they going to chump? Yeah. They're going to trade for the priest. It's kind of what I figured. Then they'll chump, chump, and cast a Ghostly Flicker on the Archaeomancer. And the Coilinocle? No? Yes? No? Maybe not? Oh, they cast the Coilinocle. This is no longer a card in their hand. All right. Are they going to flicker? Interesting. Are they going to flicker this? They don't want to trade for the priest? I really would have thought they would have wanted to trade for that priest, especially considering they have two Coiling Oracles in play and a Visionary in hand. I would have just tried to get some power off of the board, and especially get a creature type off of the board. Still, I got to decide if I want to keep this Lavamancer. I still think I do. I think it's just really important with the Reckless Bushwhacker. I don't know. Maybe that's crazy. Yep, another Oracle. And they revealed another fucking Oracle. Wow. And another one. Okay. And that one hits a forest. Are they going to Visionary? They're going to keep up Ghostly Flicker. Okay. Ooh. That's a nice one. That only costs 2 mana, although we could almost hard cast it anyways, but make these unblockable. Now we have two 5-4 Tramplers. Actually, I think we might have this here because they've drawn a ton of cards, but they're just not putting anything onto the board. They just have a pile of 1/1s. The next, and then we'll, I think regardless here, we're playing Lavamancer post-combat. I mean, they have to trade off now. Yeah, I can double block, but it has a trample. This is very much a lethal attack right now. So they got to have something, because that's not how trample works. If they flicker this, maybe they're going to flicker these and trade here, eat up ones. That's 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's still lethal, I think. 4, 5. Yeah, plus there's 3 here. It's 3, 4. Oh no, he flickered the one blocking the trampler. Again, that does not work. Hold on. I don't think it matters. Oh, it's not lethal. Huh. Oh, this doesn't have trample. I don't know why I thought it had trample. People are probably screaming at their screens right now. I thought this had trample. It does not. Okay. Well, now I'm definitely playing a Lavamancer. So, I mean, they have to kill Lavamancer and both Dodgers. I don't think they play Wraths in a deck like this because they're a very heavy creature deck. Yeah, and they scoop. Okay. So they're playing like Coiling Oracles, Archaeomancers, I think Neoforms, Ghostly Flickers. What do I want? I like the Arc Trail idea. They're playing a lot of basics, so I don't think we want price.
Chain Lightning seems interesting against some of their value creatures. Like, I think they probably play Hostage Taker. They might not be three color. I don't like Reckless Wave. They're probably playing Birds of Paradise. Yeah, I just don't love these Grim Lavamancers, especially against a deck like this. They're just not putting that many things into our graveyard. So I'm fine cutting one of those. Maybe like one Instigator. Yeah, this seems fine. The other card I've thought about playing in the one drop slot, because that's the tricky one, is the 1/1 Changeling for one. It's like, it's just a 1/1 for one, but it does count for every type of thing in the party. Plus it's a goblin for Goblin Grenade. So I'm kind of interested in that card. But it is a just Mons Goblin Raiders basically. So, eh. I'd be happy with the Changeling Outcast, the 1/1 unblockable for one. That card I would like actively want to play, which is, but it's black. The 1/1 Changeling. The other thing is that it's an artifact. So it doesn't pump Foundry Street Denizen, which is always a little bit awkward. It's not red. Foundry Street Denizen only counts red creatures. So, you know, little anti-synergies are tough. Like, you kind of want a card like that that's just a pure synergy card. It's like a really low power level card that you're only playing because of how it interacts with your cards, with the other cards to work with all of your other cards. See. Pause. Okay. What do we think about this hand? Turn one Foundry Street, turn two Tin Street Dodger. If Priest, Rogue, Warrior, Wizard, Shatter Skull, only one land, but there are 3/1 drops and we're on the draw. Nah, this hand's like so bad against like one Coiling Oracle if we don't draw lands. I think I'm gonna ship it. All right, I'll keep this. This hand's worse, but that hand needed to draw lands. This hand needs to draw creatures. If it's draw creatures, though, this is a really powerful one. All right, I'll take a Groteg butt. I can't stop saying Groteg Butt Catcher. Not even on purpose. Riftwing Cloudscape, sure. Cloudscape's a nice one because I'm pretty sure this deck is the Neoform deck, that if you can Neoform it away and it's a 5-drop. So next turn, I can Priest plus Bushwhacker. Hopefully I draw 1-drop. That would be ideal. Coiling Oracle, sure. Hinterland Harbor. And 1/1 Rampant Growth with that body is great. Magic of the Future. Oh, yeah. The deck does some interesting stuff with, like, Magic of the Future. I forget how that all works, though. Okay. Priest. Bushwhacker. Attack. They can trade. Looks like that's what they're going to do. I don't love that, but at least they take 4. They're playing Magic of the Future. All right. It's also a 2/3. Jeez. It's just like big. All right. I mean, I guess I'll just kick this. Attack with both. I assume they don't block here. You know, they definitely don't block because this would trade. Oh, I guess they can just eat this shit. That was stupid.
Well, maybe they're hesitant about it. No, they're not. They take three. This was a mistake, but we're going to play around it. What I should have done, clearly, was to keep the bushwhacker back, just attack for three, and then goblin grenaded the mages. I mean, we're pretty screwed here, but we'll see. Maybe they just draw terribly. I'm not really sure what we draw here.
That gets us back into this. We don't...
Because we need a board to really go off, and or a hand.
So the 5-4 haste would be good, but we're not really that close to being able to cast it. So take two. Yeah, fuck this.
I guess we should have played it out for... Arc Trail would have been nice. I don't know. We were not doing well in that game.
Okay.
I think I still like our sideboard plan. We still have two Lava Mancers. I didn't see anything that made me want Harsh Mentor. Yeah. Seems fine.
I really wish we had fetch lands. That would make a big difference in this deck. All right, we just need a really good draw. Ugh, keep drawing. Awkward. I'm going to keep this, I think. I don't know. We play a Tin Street Dodger on turn one, then we can kill their next play. We don't have another one drop, though. But we do have, like, a decent amount of burn. If we draw a land, we can go Instigator into Bushwhacker. Plus, we have the Arc Trail. I don't know.
This is a land away from being a good hand. Plus, at least we play something on turn one. If we don't draw land, obviously we're pretty screwed. All right, they played a birds. If I draw land, I think. I think I'm going to play an Instigator. I have an Arc Trail in hand. I think I'm going to get a little greedy here. Attack for one.
Try to get my 2-for-1 with the Arc Trail. And then I have 8 points of burn. Because this Chain Lightning can go face instead of killing something. I think this is like... The Chain Lightning's the safer play, but this is like more likely to actually win the game.
Okay.
I mean, Arc Trailing a Spring Bloom Druid is not like an amazing play, but at least they can't blink it. They get their little bit of value, but they only get one land. Ooh, nice. Okay. Well, doesn't matter. I could Chain Lightning face. I don't think I need to do that. Attack for three. Coiling Oracle. They got a Neoform. Okay. Are they going to Neoform the Coiling Oracle into what? What three drop can they get? Champion of Wits, sure. Yeah, Champion of Wits is a card I played in the Neoform deck. It's nice because you draw equal to the number of cards, or to its power, and then discard that many cards. Or then discard two, not that many, discard two. So you draw three, discard two, because Neoform puts into a play with the +1/+1 counter, which is kind of like a part of this card that it's easy to forget because the way that it's usually used is just like, it's just about putting the card into play. It really doesn't matter. Like most of the time in Modern, that the +1/+1 counter when you're getting a Gristlebrand, but that is what the card does. So this turn I'm going to Chain Lightning then Bushwhacker. Ooh, that's nice. I think, right, if I Bushwhacker and then they block here, they take 2, 4, 6, 8. It's 3 damage either way.
I'm just wondering whether I should just go face with the Chain Lightning and let them eat something. But either way, like they'll block the priest. So that's 3 damage either way. And this one guarantees to get the thing off the board. And now I have lethal with a Gamma Grenade, so. Sure. Okay. Yeah, I think they try to put together Prophet of Krufix plus Mage of the Future is the idea. Yeah, they can play 2 things to block. I think I'm trying to think whether I should attack first, but the fact that I can't play this instant speed makes me just want to go for it. I don't think they play any counter spells, and they really shouldn't have them in against this deck. Counter magic's usually not great against Monorad. Sweet. Whew, we did it. All right. 3-0. Nice. Despite the deck feeling like, you know, it's not drawing particularly well, especially, you know, I was goldfishing this a while, and it feels like these are definitely are on the lower end of draws. So the fact that we're still 3-0 is great. So I will see you all back for round 4. Round 4, here we go, against Wow Bees. Fun name. We're going to play first. Let's try to get a non-mulligan, which has not been a lot of this game. It's funny that they say, like, what we rolled. I just always thought that was weird, like, that they still had to prove, no, it's a dice roll, as opposed to just saying we randomized this. I can't keep this hand. If these were, like, Goblin Bushwhackers, maybe, but I can't cast most of these Reckless Bushwhackers, or can't cast any of them right now, so I'm going to have to mulligan this, unfortunately. Okay, this one I'm definitely keeping. So, what am I putting back? I think I'm putting back the Goblin Grenade. Yeah, we need both lands. I want to keep this Priest Electromancer combo, especially with the Shatter Skull. And we need the 1-1 Rogue so that we can go Rogue, Cleric, Wizard, Minotaur, or Warrior. So we're going to put back the Goblin Grenade. Grenade, like, is such a powerful burn spell, but it is... It doesn't have synergy with the rest of the deck in the sense, you know what I mean? It's not taking creatures off the board hurts the party plan. So the party planning committee decided to not play it. Forest, go. Okay. Ooh, that's a nice draw. Well, yeah, fuck it. Let's just do it now. Fuck it. We'll do it live. Sloppy play, but whatever. What are they going to do? Kill something with a forest? Ha, huh. I'd like to see them try. All right, land. Please, one time land. Forest, mountain. Farseek, okay. So some sort of forest, mountain, Farseek deck, looks like. Cool. Huh, ice tunnel. Oh, these have land types. I did not remember that these had land types. Cool. Bushwhacker, I mean, it would be great to play these, like, to play it off of these, but I already have the Minotaur to play next, so I'm just going to slam in with the Bushwhacker. So that's cool. I was wondering why they're playing Farseek instead of Rampant Growth in a deck without, in a format without shock lands or dual lands, but I did not remember that these ice, these snow lands had basic land types. What is this? Grenzo. Oh, interesting. Some sort of Grenzo combo deck. Cool. Land, please. Please land. Hooray, land. Oops. Yep. Priest. Electromancer. Boom. They can eat the Bushwhacker if they want, but yeah, I figured that's probably where they'll trade. They go to 3. Not quite
quite sure what they're doing with Grenzo. Could play a Harsh Mentor. Not sure. All right, another Grenzo. Sure. It's not going to do it. What's the other thing? Sure. They're still very dead, right? Block here, block here. Yeah. Yeah, okay. They just scooped. Nice. That was a really good draw, even on a mulligan. Okay. So, not sure what they're doing. I know there are some cool things you can do with Grenza, but I'm trying to remember. I forget. You can kind of do cool things with the London Mulligan rule and Grenzo, is you put back something that's like a star power, and that counts as zero. So they were playing five colors, but they played so many basics that game that I'm wondering if Price of Progress is actually good. I think I'm going to not put them in yet. They played the Grenzos. They played Sylvan Caryatid. So, you know, Chainlight's not good against Sylvan Caryatid and may or may not be good against Grenzo. Try cutting an Instigator for a Mentor. Reckless Waif actually might be fine. Maybe it's worse on the draw. Maybe I'll play it, put it on the play, and I'll play Chain Lightning. We'll see how that goes. Yeah, I don't know. We're gonna see. We're up a game. That's big. Winning game one is obviously really important for this deck. Yeah, this is a really good hand. Turn one, Denizen. Turn two, I mean, it's not a great turn two. Oh, they have a companion. I didn't even notice that. And they suspended a search for tomorrow. Where is it? Sorry, let me do this. Let me do this. Yeah, you know what? Fuck the companion. Just keep the search there. Okay. Sorry about all that. Ooh, nice. All right, we're going to have a very, very, very explosive turn three, assuming we can keep stuff on the board. Caryatid, sure. Give me a two drop. That would be obviously perfect. Okay, another one drop actually works fine. Because that gets this so that it can go back past the Caryatid. So they can either lose the Caryatid and take one, or they can block the thing and take three. Yeah. All right, next turn we're going to go Electromancer, Bushwhacker. And if we draw another one drop, we can even do that too. We have Warrior Rogue, so yeah, we'll make three mana, but we only need to make two. All right, so they're searching for tomorrow. Remind me what Jegantha does. No more. No card in your starting deck has more than one of the same mana symbol in its cost. Yeah, okay, that's what I thought. And yeah, it's five. All right, they're going to Farseek. So they're doing a lot of wheel spinning. Not quite sure where it all ends up. But, ooh, Canyon Slow. Well, there's a lot of cards that have basic land types. Farseek's kind of powerful. Although, I mean, yeah, because you're getting ETB tap lands, but Farseek, you already do that. I don't know how much damage this is, but it's a fucking shit ton. I don't think it's lethal. I'm not going to count it. It's going to be a fun surprise. Come on, one drop. Ooh. No, that doesn't work. Okay, always yield. Always yield, just for fun. I think that's more than lethal. Woo! Wow, that's an explosive draw for this deck. turn three kill on the draw. Really nice.
I mean, they cast a Search Tomorrow and two Far Seeks, a Sylvan Caryatid. So they did a lot of wheel spinning. But yeah, this is the kind of explosive, awesome draws that this deck can have. So we are 4-0, cooking with gas. Let's see if we can get the trophy, despite the fact that there are no trophies. But we'll see how it goes in round five. Okay, here we go. Round five for most of the marbles. And we are on the play. And we have a hand. See, this one I'm going to blame the deck on. This is just clunky. We have three lands and four spells. Three creatures, one burn spell. Theoretically, this is a great draw, but it's not a great draw. Or a great hand. Yeah, this is a mulligan. Okay. I can get behind this. Huh. What am I bottoming, though? So it'll be a much better seven. I could bottom the priest, or I could bottom the goblin grenade. This is the kind of hand where goblin grenade is pretty good, but also this is the kind of hand where priest into reckless bushwhacker is really good. And I'm going to bottom the priest. We don't have the mana to cast it right now. I like this mono denizen plan. We obviously want to draw something after, because turn two, we're probably going to go two denizens, attack for three. And then we can, like, if we can just draw even just a Goblin Instigator, then all of these become 3/1s. All right, more Cloudpost. Okay. Land was not ideal, but at least means that we can play, like, our 3-drops. Bushwhacker would be the perfect draw, I assume. Even Reckless Bushwhacker would be fine. All right, so we only need to get them down to 15, although Glimmer Post makes that tricky. Yeah, this is like not a great hand against Glimmer Post. It's also, it's just like not a great hand against Cloud Post. It is fast, at least. They're like, ooh, Blue Post. Cool. They keep you up counter magic? Oof. All right, well, that was not what we wanted to draw. But, you know, at least we're attacking for three. It's not perfect, but three damage is three damage. The Goblin Grenade in hand. Seems like they probably had a counter spell. Oof, Glimmer Plus, fuck. Yeah. Pass the turn again, I assume. We're just going to play Drago with like a Condescend up or something. All right, we'll jam that into a counterspell. Do your worst. Hmm. They didn't have it. Kind of assumed they had it. Attack for six here, unless they have like some flash blocker. It's possible they're like green blue post and just are missing their color, I guess. But they have seven cards in hand. What could they have? They're probably a card draw spell at the end of turn. What it looks like. Fact or fiction? All right. They can have like factory or and two behold the multiverse or something versus land Augur Bolas. They're probably just gonna take Augur. Yeah. This seems fine. Definitely want to put the beholds together. Yeah. Yeah, maybe I should have given them factory plus Augur in case they needed that double blue. They definitely, like, two Behold the Multiverses are not useful, so giving them both. Oh, man, they just drew a Glimmer Post. Oh, man, that's brutal. They didn't even fact or fiction into it or anything like that. Just they just drew two Glimmer Posts. That's tough. Kaiga. Kaiga style. Okay. Oh my god. Get the fuck out of here.
I could attack for three.
Nah.
Rough draws. What is this? Auger? Sure. Two mana, look at the bottom three cards of your library? No.
Damn. Hidden opt.
Okay. Goblin Instigator is a pretty fucking good draw. I was actually just thinking that that's one weirdly one of our best draws here. They have four mana. They can't even condescend this or mana leak it. Because we can pay for either. I don't know if they... I assume they play something like condescend. Well, they're casting something. Is it just an opt? Oh, wait, no, they have... No, sorry. They have five mana. Spellburst. Oh. Shit. Okay. That sucks. All right. Do they buy it back? No, they couldn't have bought it back. Yeah, I was miscounting the number of lands. So they could have, if they had condescend, they could have played it. I think we're kind of drawing dead here, but maybe like they go for an attack, we swing and draw goblin grenades, something like that. They foretold a Behold the Multiverse, I assume. This deck does seem pretty cool. Behold is a nice card for them. All right, let's pack it in. Damn. Okay. An Augur is a really good one against this. I like the Reckless Waifs on the play for sure over the Lavamancers. That seems very good to me. Do I like Price of Progress? Yeah, probably. It is an instant, which is kind of nice. Take out a grenade for a price and maybe a Shatter Skull for a price. All right, I'm into that.
Reckless Waves do seem really good, but yeah, Aggro Bolas is a bitch against us. That hand never came together. Drawing six lands with a triple Foundry Street Denizen in hand is not ideal. Yes, we'll play first. Man. All right. This is a keep. Still a land-heavy hand, but it's a keep.
Island go, island map. Okay. Ooh, nice. Boat catcher. So if they have like a spell blast, they can't counter anything. They have mana leak. And I would assume they're probably taking out their mana leaks, but could have counterspell. That's in the format now. Ugh, Augur. Well, Augur can't actually do that. Doesn't do that much against Boatcatcher. They picked up an opt again. Okay. So this puts us to just two parties two. I mean, we're about to go up to party of four, but we never get a chance to cast Minotaur. I could attack. Do I want to attack with a Tin Street Dodger? Probably not. They can just pick it off for free. I guess I could attack with the Dodger because it's a 2-1 also. So they can either pick off the Bushwhacker. I mean, I guess they probably pick off the Dodger. That's fine. I think I'd rather get in the 2 points of damage. So they eat that because this is the one that can do damage later on. It does reduce this by one. But otherwise, I'm just suiciding the Bushwhacker, and so that's not that good either. It's really good getting all this stuff on the board early on. That's like really big. The one awkward thing is that they like, right now they eat the, I guess we don't have a party for. Yeah, never mind. Oh, okay, they trade. Interesting. I was going to say they eat the Tin Street Dodger and the priest can never attack again, but they just traded for the priest. I think that's a bad block. Next turn we get to play Minotaur. Three islands. So they're not even cracking map main phase. What is this? Another auger. Okay. That's pretty good. That makes more sense. Their block. They got a Foff. Okay. Playing the Shatterskull Minotaur. Then attacking with, I think just the bug catcher and this. Otherwise, like if we attack with both of these, they can eat this. This will be 8-10 damage. So I get in for two, or if they eat here, I get in for one extra. Getting the rogue off the board is awkward because that means that I no longer have a rogue. So I think this is my attack, especially because I have a Bushwhacker effect in hand. Having more creatures in play is good. I mean, I want to be pushing as much as I possibly can early in the game, but I also like keeping the more creatures on the board is better. They also don't have any cloud posts in play. So things like Glimmer Post are not as backbreaking. They gain one life. All right, they're just going to chump, which is a definitely reasonable play and would have been potentially a reason to attack with these, but they didn't opt. Why didn't they opt? They might have just forgotten. Ooh, and they scooped. Okay. For a second, I thought we had, I just reacted like we had won the match. We did not. We won the game. All right, I still don't want Smash. I mean, they could also be playing Platinum Angel. I don't think so, though. Reckless Waifs are definitely worse on the draw, but I think they're better than Labomancers still. Chain Lightning. Do I like Chain Lightning against the Augur Boluses? It's not like the worst. Maybe I don't like Price of Progress all that much. I mean, they had one game where they didn't draw any Cloud Posts, but they probably only have like 9 non-basics in their deck or 10, something like that. They probably play like the 8 Cloud Post cards plus I saw they had Urza's Factory. Maybe they play like a Ghost Quarter or something like that. All right, let's try this. Maybe Shatterskull is better. I don't know. It does kind of embarrass Augur. I mean, we do have like the Grotek bug catchers are good against Augur, as are the Ardent Electromancer, because the 3/2s are good. Oof. All right. Keep this. Yeah, we're definitely bottoming the grenade here. We just have to hope we can resolve stuff. All right, they went to 6 also. It's always a good sign. Hey, we got our grenade back. What we really need is a land, but we want to draw, our ideal would be land into Bushwhacker. Either one is fine. We do have 20 lands and 8 bushwhackers, so it's not insane that that could be our two draws, but we're not favored to draw those. Okay. Island to island go. Man, I wish this was a reckless wave. I'm fine running a Goblin Instigator into a counterspell. Doesn't even add to our party count. If they want to spend their whatever mana leak on this, which they probably will. Oh, counterspell. Sure.
Yeah, I'm very annoyed that this is in the format. Now we have counterspell and him to Torak in the format. That's just a barrel of fun. Eh, no cloud posts. And they only have 4 cards left. But we don't really have anything going on. Bottle gnomes. Okay. Land. Oh. No. Never mind. I was going to say we actually can't go to Electromancer into Electromancer, but we can. No Bushwhacker here, but can at least do this. Still, you know, bunch of power on board. There's, I guess, theoretically consideration to gobble-gridding the Bottle Gnomes, but that seems bad. It's only shutting down the Priest right now from attacking. Now that they just, like, they have to deal with it, so they have to start tapping out a little bit. And Aggro Bolas, all right, Glimmer Post gain 1. So they can gain 3 more. They go up to, they're at a virtual 21 right now. Yeah, I mean, that's good. It's not unbeatable, though. All right, they get their map. And what's this? Ooh, another Bottle Gnomes. And they're mismatched. God, have some self-respect. It's fucking Penny Dreadful. Cards are not expensive. All right. I mean, I'm going to attack with a Tin Street and these two. They can double block, but if they double block, they kill one of the 3/2s, but then their Bottle Gnome can't be sacrificed. Ooh, they only have 1 card in hand. They are at virtual 24. This grenade looks pretty bad against Bottle Gnomes. Like, burn is not good against life gain. Much rather this be a creature. All right. Yeah, we'll trade. I don't love our position here, but at least we have a board presence. If this was the olden days, they could have made that double block and then sacked the Bottle Gnomes because they could put damage on the stack, but that has not been the rule in quite some time. I think they put damage back on the stack, or took the damage off the stack right when I was starting to play Magic for the third time, and then when I started playing, the first time I started playing more seriously. I played a bit in elementary school, and then in middle school, and a little bit high school, and then it wasn't until college that I started playing more seriously. Seriously enough. What are they doing? Foretelling? Yeah. Whatever could it be? Oh. God. Just bad draws. All right. That's so, so bad here. I really, 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 really needed to punish them tapping out. Because now they're going to just start overwhelming me with card advantage. I think we're kind of fucked. Like, if we had drawn the Shatter Skull Giant, that would have been so much better there. Oh, they're beholding main phase. Interesting. All right, at least they bottom-bottomed. So they drew 2 random cards. Chain Lightning would be okay. Get the Bottlenose off the board at least. All right, they're opting. Yeah, all right, I'm just going to keep this stuff up. If they're going to be scrying a bunch, might as well see what they're doing. They snap bottomed. Probably a land, I guess. Probably like an island. Weird that the log says they put a card on the bottom, then it says they scryed one. It's weird that these are two different steps, and it's weird that this is the order that it says them. Is this a auger maybe? Yeah. All right, whiff one time. You have like all these like bottle gnomes and maps and all sorts of shit in your deck. You don't deserve to hit with auger bowls. Lands, more augers. Oh, fuck off. And they have the mana to foretell it. Oh, go away, you. All right. That's a good draw. So they can double block the Ardent Electromancer, but again, they lose their Bottle Gnomes if they do that without gaining the life. And now this Priest trades for either of those things. I am going to attack with the Bushwhacker, I think. So they can like block here, or they could like block here, take six. If I don't attack with a Bushwhacker, I almost didn't attack with anything. I'm gonna attack with a Bushwhacker. I don't know, not 100% on that attack. I think that's probably what they do, is they trade Augur for Priest and then eat the Bushwhacker and take six. Yeah. They go to four. Huh. I'm thinking about Goblin Grenading now. They don't have counter magic up. It's not going to kill them, because they can sack the Bottle Gnomes, but it basically kills their Bottle Gnomes, and then they go up to seven, then they go down to two, and then I have the Electromancer play. It is awkward that I have to lose my 10 Street Dodger, which is one of the things that can force through like 2 points of damage, but I think it makes sense here. It means they have to tap out to put a blocker into play for this Ardent Electromancer next turn. Or not tap out, but they have to tap some mana. Oh, fuck. They just didn't sack the Bottle Gnomes. Okay, well, I'll take it. Fuck it. I mean, that's not how I figured we'd win that. But, yeah, misclicks, they happen. We had a lot of them. So I think we got a little lucky to 5-0. I feel like we didn't draw particularly well with this deck. And we definitely got some misclicks from our opponent. But 5-0 is 5-0. And this deck is really sweet. And especially for a deck that has some inconsistencies, it's really powerful and it's not as inconsistent as you'd expect. Like, and it feels like the fact that even when it's drawing some of its more clunky draws, it can, you know, 5-0 against five real decks. We play against mono red, blue post, green post. That Neoform deck's a real thing. That deck's pretty sweet. And something else. Can't remember what the last one was. What was it? Mono red, two posts, Neoform, whatever. Anyways, yeah, I think it shows that deck's got a lot of promise. And yeah, it's really fun to play, especially when it draws a little better than this, when you're just like chaining Electromancer / Priest effects into Bushwhackers and all this stuff. You can really just do stupid amounts of damage out of nowhere. Ooh, okay. Knock the thing away. Anyways, thank you all for watching, and I will be back with some more Sweet Penny Dreadful decks. I got a few in the pipeline that I want to play. Yes, a lot of them do include Goblin Dark Dwellers and Seething Song, because I haven't recorded in a while, but it's still the thing I love the most. So anyways, thanks again for watching, and I will be back soon.
Oh, shit.